Good morning, students. Today, let us have a webinar related to the predictive analytics. So, titled as predictive analytics. So, we are going to discuss what is predictive analytics and then why it matters, followed by two business cases we are going to discuss, which will help you as a techno manager to make the decisions according to that. Okay, so first, let us start with what is predictive analytics? I hope you hear this word predictive analytics in the webinar, business analytics itself. So actually in analytics, we have three categories. First one, descriptive analytics, followed by predictive, and then last one, prescriptive analytics. So now in today's webinar, we are going to focus only this predictive analytics. So even though we are focusing predictive analytics, let me start with the descriptive analytics. What is descriptive analytics? Actually, in previous days, since we have a data in our hand, that is, we can go through the data and then we can come for some conclusion based on the data in our hand. That is descriptive analytics. Followed by, if the companies or organization wants to know what will happen in future, we may go with this predictive analytics. That is what predictive analytics is coined. And then last one, so once we identify this is what happened in future, then we may give as an analyst or as a techno manager, we may give suggestions or actions to improve our business, to improve their business. That is what coined as prescriptive analytics. Now let us define what is predictive analytics. It allows the companies to become proactive or forward-looking or anticipating outcomes and behaviors. In simple words, it's a branch of advanced analytics, which will be useful to make the decision regarding the future events. That is what predictive analytics is. I hope you can understand, you can follow my words. And so in this slide, you can see the picture. It's a pictorial representation of the predictive analytics. So we have a data in our hand. As a first step, we can make a reporting, or we can simply analyze what we have in our hand, and followed by we can monitor the data. That is what happened in the past. That is what we are going for, monitoring the data. And in future, we can make the decision. This is what going to happen. That is predictive analytics. In a simple words, that is this pictorial representation is easily explained. What is predictive analytics? I hope now you that is clear about what this terminology, predictive analytics, says. Actually, before this term has been coined, what happened in our business? So in the traditional business intelligence, what has happened? So you must aware that is in a previous, for example, you take a very simple store, that is Kannan department store. They have lot of transactions to, daily. So that is what they maintain some customers based on their memory. They can identify these customers are regular customers. That is what happened in past without this predictive analytics and everything has been coined. They can identify only the customers who are all regular to their store. Apart from that, they can identify this is what going currently. This is the current trend of our business. Up to this only, they can identify, they can find out in their business. Even though they are want to, you know, that is improve their business, but the decision is in hand is this is what we have, they have. But once the predictive analytics has been coined, it will help the companies or organization or even the Kannan department store. It will help to identify the customer's behavior in future, how the customer will behave in future, whether they will retain their store or they will switch over to some other store. Likewise, they can predict these are all the customers are regular to their store in future. Not only the customer regularity, and then based on the regularity, they can improve their business by giving some offers to their regular customers. So in tradition, that nothing, these are all not at all possible, but once the predictive analytics has been coined, these are all can happen. That is the advantage of predictive analytics. Now, I hope you can understand how this predictive analytics is important, why it is matters. It's not only to identify the customers, as I told in a previous slide itself, it's not only identify the customers or customers, regular customers, based on the customer's response and behavior, the organization or the company can improve their opportunities to retain the customer, to identify their profitable customers, or to attract their customers. Likewise, they can improve their business level. That is what predictive analytics matters. That is, and one more point, according to the companies, they are very interested to apply this predictive analytics concept in a forecast inventory and manage the resources. What will be the revenue? Forecast inventory, in the sense they can easily identify what will be the revenue for next year or after 2 years or after 3 years. They can easily identify. Based on that, they can apply some actions or suggestions in their business for betterment of their business. Am I right? So that is the first point. And then the second one, to manage the resources. For example, if the Kannan department stores identifies this is what going to happen in the next year, 2021, they can immediately take action. They can open one more store nearby this location or in some other location so that they can manage their resources too. That is very important. So not only attract the customers, this predictive analytics helps in the way of improving their inventory as well as manage their resources. So that is what predictive analytics matters. I hope now we enter into the what is predictive analytics, how it differs from the previous traditional business intelligence, followed by this, why the predictive analytics matters in all the organization, why we always talking about predictive analytics in our as a techno managers, you must aware the importance of this predictive analytics. I hope you can follow my words. Okay, and then little bit now in this slide, I'm going to little bit technical, that is, I'm going to introduce two more terminologies related to the predictive analytics. So here we coined that is two terminologies, regression and classification. These two are the forms of predictive analytics. So once we decide we are going to apply the predictive analytics in our business, then we have to make the decision which form you are going to apply. That is very important. Based on the business problem, you have to choose either regression problem or classification problem. So first, let me define what is regression and what is classification. Then you can easily, choose what form can be used for the given scenario. Okay, so first regression. So the regression actually, it is a predictive analytics. It's using for making predictions regarding your future event. That is same for, what will happen in future. But the thing is, it also helps to identify the relationship between the variables. I hope you can understand what is the relationship between the variables. Actually, for example, I'm telling, if you want to predict the salary of employee, what will be the salary of employee in the next year, if you want to make this prediction. Okay, so salary is our that is what we are going to predict. It's one of the variable. It's called as a variable. And then how we can make this prediction based on the qualification of the employee. Am I right? So qualification always helps to make the prediction of salary. Am I right? So that is what qualification is, another variable. So first, before you decide based on the qualification, I'm going to fix the salary. This is what our final decision. For example, I'm telling. So before you decide this thing, you have to identify whether there is any relationship between these two. Then only you can go for further prediction. Otherwise, there is no use of this prediction. For example, if first you have to identify whether there is a relationship between qualification and then salary. Definitely there is a relationship. Am I right? So once the UG graduate, they will get a minimum salary. Once they have completed their PG, definitely their salary will get hike. Similarly, again, they go for higher qualification, definitely their salary will get increased. So there is a relationship between salary as qualification and salary. So based on this, they can fix the salary. Once you find out there is a relationship between these two, we can go for prediction of salary based on their qualification. For example, one more example, if you are consider age, is age depends on this, is age is has a relationship between that is salary and then age, that is not necessary. Actually, even the person's age is more than 40, but still he has completed only undergraduate, then there is no use of these things. That is, we can't give a high salary for the person since he is more than 40 years old. Am I right? So that is the thing. So first you have to identify the relationship among the variables, then you have to choose the variable according to the relationship and go for prediction. So this is what happened in the regression. I hope you can understand now what this regression tells. Regression is a one form of predictive analytics which helps to make a prediction. Before that, it identifies the influencing variable for the particular prediction, and based on that, it can go for prediction. And then in this slide itself, we have one more term, that is classification. Am I right? So classification. So what for it is? It is again a form of predictive. It is also for making predictions. But the thing is here, we have to, at the end of the prediction, what happened is, it is categorized the given data into more than one categories. It's not necessary, or it's categorized into two levels or three levels and so on. It depends on the scenario, what we have in our hand. So based on that, at the end of the prediction, entire data has been classified into more than one groups. That is what happened as a classification. From the term itself, you can understand the concept behind this classification. We are classifying these observations, or these persons are related to computer science department, these persons are related to management department, and so on, based on their qualification or what else, based on their specialization. So that is what happened in a classification problem. I hope you all can understand the two terminologies associated to the predictive analytics. Okay, students, now it's time for polling. Okay, I hope you already have experience on this polling. So now I am going to display two questions. Okay, regarding this, the concepts, simple concept what we learned so far. So it is based on that you try to answer for the questions given. I have given two scenarios. You have to identify whether both the scenarios are fall in the category of regression or in the category of classification. It's very simple to follow. Let us start this polling right now. Okay, I launch the polling questions. So this is the first question. Okay, now I want to share the results to you. You can see the results. Nearly 68% of students voted as it is a regression problem, and remaining 32% voted as it's a classification problem. I'll explain you. Actually, a television company wants to understand the viewership decline. It's an organization. They want to understand the viewership decline. So that is, they have to identify why this XYZ show is getting down. What is the reason of this XYZ show is getting down? They want to know the what are all the factors influenced in this particular show. Why the show's screening is getting low, the number of viewers is getting low. So that, I hope it is a regression problem. It's not a classification. Am I right? They want to know the influencing factor of this prediction. They want to make prediction, but they want to indirectly, they want to identify the influencing factors of that particular problem. Okay. Again, I'll give the second question. only few percentage, 19% voted it as a regression problem, but remaining percentage, 86% of students voted as classification. I'm happy to see this result actually. Yes, it is right, because here the bank loan officer wants to identify the person, whether the person is a risky person or not. So he need a classification. He wants to classify whether a given person is comes in this group or non-risky group. Risky group or non-risky group. So that is what this problem comes under the category of classification. I'm happy to see your results. Thank you, students. Okay, now we move on to the our presentation. Okay. Actually, in this webinar, just I want to introduce the terminology predictive analytics and its importance. I hope everybody can understood that is the importance of predictive analytics and what predictive analytics says. Followed by in this webinar, we are going to discuss, as I told earlier, we are going to discuss two business cases. Since you are become a techno managers, you must aware how to handle a case given to you. Okay, so that is what here we are discussing this two business cases related to predictive analytics. Okay, in this slide you can see the first case, business case one. So what the problem statement? Actually, a car company from China, they want to launch their own manufacturing unit in US market, and then locally they wants to manufacture cars and then sell in the same US market with the competition of US and European counterparts. That is very important. Already in US market we have US cars as well as European cars, so this China company wants to compete with them by launching their own unit, manufacturing unit in US itself. That is what this is the plan of a car company from China. So as a techno manager, first what you have to do, this actually to solve this case, technical knowledge is not much important. Actually, that is, we are not touching the technical portion of this problem. That is, we are going to have a discussion only related to your own side, that is techno manager side. Okay, so first we have to clear about the problem given in our hand. This is what the problem. Okay, I hope everybody can understand, everybody can follow the problem given. So okay, now we have to decide. Now we go move on to the next slide. In this slide you can view, that is first thing, you have to identify the objective or goal. So what for this analysis is, what is the goal at the end of the analysis, what we have to find out, that is the first point. And then followed by, and then actually to once you fix this is what going to happen, or this is what they need as a result, next what you have to do, you have to collect the data. You have to ensure whether we have data in our hand, right data in our hand, am I right? So that is what this slide shows. First thing is you have to fix your goal. Okay, what is our goal? We have to understand what are all the variables, what are all the variables influenced to predict the price of a car, am I right? So as a car company, what is their motive? They want to launch a company, manufacturing unit in US market. At the same time, they have to fix the price of car also. So first they must aware what are all the variables are influencing to fix the price of car. That is the first point. So here it is a regression problem. I hope you can understand. It's a regression problem, and then you have to this is what we are going to finalize as a result. Okay, and then followed by prediction. So okay, once you fix these are all the features to be influenced to make a prediction of car price, then you can go for prediction easily. That is not a big problem. Okay, and the next one, this is the goal, and then you have to collect the data. Actually, in our data, for what we take as an example in this case, that is in our data, actually we called it as a data set. So a data set contains the relevant specification of 205 cars, 205 cars. Actually, it's all these cars are available in US market, already available in US market. You have to collect the cars details. What are all the specifications are required, or what are all the specifications are available? Specification in the sense that is like car, who is the manufacturer of that car, and then whether it is a sedan car or some other type of car, or whether it is what is the fuel type of this car, and the engine type of this car, everything you have to collect all the specification of a single car. Similarly, we are collecting 26 specification of each and every car. Entirely collectively, we have how many data in our hand? 205 cars details, 205 cars, and then 26 specification of each car in our hand. This is what we have in our hand as a data. Okay, now I hope everybody, you got a problem statement followed by you fix your goal. This is what I'm going to find out at end of this analysis. And then I'm having a data like this. Okay, now we can start our process. So what we have to start? It is result of visualization. That is, in this slide, actually, I did some calculations to observe all these things. Actually, this is you just ignore the technical portion. Just you concentrate. This is what the result we got. After some technical process, we got this is the result we got. Just you assume like that. Based on that, you have to come for some conclusion. That is what we are going to discuss in today's webinar. I hope you can follow my words. And then, so the first thing, in the first top diagram, actually in the picture, you can see the list of, I hope how it is visible to you, because the size of the picture is very little bit small, but please adjust. Actually, I'll tell you what this picture says. That is, it depends upon the car company name. How many counts are available in a US market? Can I get my, I hope you can get my point. That is based on the company name. For example, Toyota is the first company and Mercury is the last company. So first company, how many cars are running or available in US market according to this company? That is how many cars. For a Toyota company cars, we have more number of cars available in our US market. And then again, in a Mercury company cars is available, very little bit available in our US market. So which is the most favorite car in US market? Toyota cars. Which is less favorite cars in US market? Mercury car. So that you have to first identify which company or which car company's cars are favorite for the US people. Based on the features of that car, we can proceed further. That is what we have this analysis. And the next thing, the second diagram, the second picture shows a number of gas fueled cars. So actually, the second bar is represent the right side bar represent it's of diesel cars, and then left side bar represent gas cars. So for what this US people like, US people used more number of cars. That is, almost all cars are in the type of gas fueled cars. Very little or low number of diesel fuel cars are available in US market. So they prefer to use only the gas fueled cars. Am I right? So that is, this picture shows, according to our data, this is what we obtained as a result. So far we discussed two features. Am I right? First thing is how the car companies are influencing. And the second thing is what type of fuel cars are interested or US peoples are interested to have which fuel type of cars in there by their own. Okay. Yes, some more analysis. So here in this analysis, again, we have types of cars, not company, car company. Here we have focus on the types of cars. In the types of cars, in the mid bin is very high, which represents the sedan cars. So US people always prefer to use the sedan cars compared with the remaining car types. So what this China company has to keep it in their mind that they have to manufacture the sedan type of cars in their unit. Am I right? So that is this picture says. And the next picture, the bottom picture. Actually, I hope everybody knew that we have a different driving wheel category. So in a car, actually, we are having three driving wheel category. One is front wheel category, rear wheel category, and four wheel category. Okay, so we have three driving wheel categories in usually in cars, basic three wheel categories. One is front wheel, rear wheel, and then third one is four wheel. Actually, here you can see this picture that if below bottom picture shows different chart we are using here. I hope you can identify the difference between the first picture and then second picture. In the second picture, it's a different type of chart, different type of plot. So in this plot, the first one is more number of observations fall in the out of 205 cars. We have in our hand 205 cars, am I right? So out of 205 cars, we have more number of cars are fall in the category of front wheel driving. Front wheel driving followed by rear wheel driving is minimum. Again, four wheel driving is little bit okay compared with the rear wheel driving. So we can come for conclusion mainly. They focus the US people rather than the US, the cars available in US market is designed with four wheel driving type. Okay, this is another type of plot. Actually, we are going with not a same type of plot. Actually, when you are analyzing the data, you have to use the different types of plot. That is also very much important because you no need to use always bar chart or always scatter plot or always some other plotting like box plot and so on. So you have to have a different plotting type. Then it will be easy to understand the concept. If you plot the data in different types of plot, you can easily come for some conclusion. Say yes, here in this slide, you can see three graphs. Actually, all these graphs are scatter plot. We call this as scatter plot, point plotting, point, point, point plotting. Okay, so here the first diagram shows car width and second diagram shows car length and then, car height and then car length, and the last diagram shows the car height. I'm sorry, I get confused. So first one is for car width and then car length and followed by the last one is car height. Okay, you can see the difference. Actually, the car price, actually we are placing a relationship between car length and then price. If the length is too high, then the price is also getting increased. Can you see the difference? Actually, in x-axis, we have car width. Car length or car width. The width is very low, the price is also low. Once the width is getting increased, automatically the price of the car is also getting increased. Similarly, in the second diagram also, you can see the car length, sedan car. Most preferable car in the US market is sedan, just now we discussed. So here you can see that is car length is getting increased, and then automatically the price of the car is also getting increased. But the third diagram, just you look at the third diagram. So what it says, car height is not at all important to decide the price of car. So when you decide the price of car, the car height is not an important factor. That is what we have to identify. So when you go for prediction of the car price, you need not consider the car height. This is what a main conclusion you have to come in this occasion. Am I right? So I hope you can understand. This is what the relationship between the variables. Once you finalize, these are all the factors are influencing the price of car, then you can use only those variables to make a prediction of car. It's not necessary to consider height of the car. It never influenced. Even the height is very low and the price is not affected. Even the height is very high and then the price is not at all affected. All the cost prices is scattered. There is no relationship. Can you see this one? Okay. So what are all the, I have displayed only few graphs to understand the concept. Actually, in this way, as a techno manager, in future, you have to analyze the data. It's very interesting thing, actually. You can make a plot, different types of plot based on your data, and then you can come for more number of observations. Actually, these are all the things available. We have a relationship, we don't have a relationship, or the relationship is positive, or relationship is negative. In such a way, you can collect more number of things from your data. Just 205 data we have, 205 cars data we have. Am I right? From this, what are all the things we can observe? So I showcased only the few things. But in a real time, you can observe more number of things. Okay, and then insights. So what are all the things we observed based on our analysis? The basic analysis, not much technical. That is basic analysis. Actually, these are all the points. I have listed few points. The first point is average US car price is $13,000. Approximately, US car price is $13,000. So that the new model cost price predictors variable has to be regulated and then balanced. Since we have collected more number of variables, but we have to regulate those variables to predict the cost price. Okay. And then similarly, each company's car, for example, Toyota car, it has its own range from this price to this price. Okay, similarly, in the Honda or Maruti Suzuki, whatever it is, each and every company, they have their own range to fix the price of car. And then some of the here, the last point you can see few outliers for those companies. So outlier in the sense, some of the exemptions are there in a company price. For example, even in a BMW car or some other things, and then even in a Toyota company itself, they designed a new model with all complete feature. The price may be too high. So that is called as outliers. It's according to the company's decision. Some few cars. Okay. And then again, the car manufacturers like Jaguar, BMW, Volvo are clearly on a high-end side. That is, it's very expensive. It's definitely the car price is more than the approximate price. Am I right? So these are all the some conclusions or some insights we found from our analysis. And then I definitely company name shows some effect on the price determination. Definitely. So once the branding is very important. So it's a branded car company. Definitely its price is different. And then... Yes, and then what are all the China company has also keep into account that predominating or popular factors of the car in US market, like sedan cars are most preferable cars, so that they may manufacture the sedan car instead of some other type of cars. Okay, I hope you understood how to approach a business case given. First, you have to fix the goal, followed by followed by the data, what we have. You have to analyze the data, what we have in our hand, and followed by you can make some visualizations. Based on that, you can come for some conclusion. And then based on that, technically, just later on, we have to approach this problem in some technical way. By using some programming tool, we go in little bit technical. So once you identify the result after some technical process, you can come for the conclusion. As a techno manager, you have to communicate all the things to your business client. This is our role. In a business analytics, this is our role. Okay, so now I hope now we come to the next business case. It is also, once you follow the previous case, it's very simple to follow this one also. It's a little bit different from the previous one. Actually, in this business case, what is our problem statement? Actually, you all aware that nowadays, the telecom company is so much affected because of the churn process, customer churn. So actually, especially youngsters like you, you never be in a same network always, am I right? So you want to switch over the networks frequently because of some offers giving by the company. And right now, that is once all customers are in an Airtel company, suddenly they switch over to the Jio. Again, they are not satisfied with the Jio. Again, they come back to Airtel and so on. So the... all the customers are switch over from one service provider to another service providers frequently nowadays. So that is a very big problem for the telecom companies. They want to identify how to predict the customers who are all going to be churned in future, at least in near future, so that they can protect them in their network itself. Am I right? So that is very important problem. So this is also a regression problem. It's not a classification, am I right? So they want to identify what are all the factors influenced to make a particular customer as a churned customer. So this is the problem statement. The telecom company wants to identify who are all the customer has become a churn customer in near future. That is what the thing. Okay, for that, first thing is, as we discussed in the previous case, you have to finalize the goal. The goal in the sense, that is, we have to build a model to identify the customers at high risk of churn and identify what are all the main factors influencing this. Okay. And then the next thing, data. So again, we have to collect the data. But I am taking data for this analysis is just collected data for only 4 months data. 4 months data, four consecutive months data, June, July, August, and September. Just you assume that. That's what I have in our hand. We have in our hand. The data we have in our hand is a span of four consecutive months. So informations related, what are all the informations? Like we have lot of informations like their recharging date, how much amount they recharged, and then how they used incoming calls, outgoing calls, everything we have recorded and then collected data only for 4 months. So based on this 4 months data, we can come for conclusion. That's very interesting one actually. So first thing is, once you analyze the data, we have to, and this is not actually, this is a classification too. Classification problem, I hope. Why I'm saying it's a classification, you have to identify whether the person is a churn person or not at end of the prediction. Am I right? So that is what it is, a classification. We are not predicting the car price as we discussed in a previous case. Here we are making prediction of the particular person is a churn person or not. So that it is a classification problem. Right. So here, I analyze the data in my hand, that is what's the first observation in our data, entire data, nearly 35,000 people's data is in our hand, nearly 35,000 data. So out of this 35,000 data, nearly 73% of data is non-churned persons. Only 26% are churned data, churned persons data. Okay. Yes. So what are all the things? First thing is, first actually as an analyst, we have to focus whether there is any data is missing in the month of June, July, August and September. For what? For simple conclusion. If there is no data available in the respective month, then we can say that is the most of the churn happened in the particular month. Actually, here you can see all the missing values are from September month. So you can leave that month because no data is available in the month of September. So that you can leave, you can ignore that September month data. So you have to consider only the remaining month. Remaining month missing data is less than 7%. Only 7% of data is missing. So it's not a big issue. So we can consider the remaining 3 months. And then first thing, you have to, in a given data, first you have to identify in the month of August, how actually in the September, they all are churn people, churn customer. So what happened in August month, the previous month, the persons are in a action phase. The persons are interested to move from one service provider to another service provider. Am I right? So that is action phase. You have to concentrate on this month too. And then identify the, before August month, actually June, July month are considered as the good phase. That is, they were comfortable with their service provider. They have no idea to switch over from one network to another network. That is called as good phase, followed by action phase and followed by churn phase. So based on our data in our hand, that is we categorized June, July months are good phase and then August month are action phase and then churn phases in the month of September. Okay, this is the first conclusion we made according to the data given. And then we have to focus. Actually, here I have display only a single output. That is much bore you. That is how to approach. I'm telling how to approach a problem. That is what I have to restrict with the number of graphs displayed in the PPT. So here, based on these two graphs, actually in this slide, you can see two graphs. One is incoming calls record and other one is outgoing calls record. and then the blue color represent the non churn persons, and then the mustard color represent the churn persons. Okay, here you can see the non churn persons incoming and outgoing calls. Mostly it is constant in incoming calls. Exactly, it is constant. There is no fluctuation of non churn persons in the month of June, July, even in August, even in a action phase. Am I right? But in the case of outgoing also, there's little bit fluctuation in the month of June and July, but it's constant in the August month. So there is no much fluctuation in this incoming outgoing calls of non churn person. But just you see the churn persons, you can identify. It's drastically it is getting reduced. Am I right? So that is the thing, because even in outgoing calls, so the first 2 months there is no big deviation, but in the month of August definitely it comes down. So what we have to identify based on this graph, we can come for conclusion: the persons who are all interested to switch over from one service provider to another service provider, they are automatically, they reduce their incoming and outgoing calls, because they are searching for some other options. They are using some other network for trial, maybe. Okay, this is what we have to conclude here. Therefore, this monthly calls is a key feature, is a the important factor to predict the churn person. So in this way, you have to identify, analyze what are all the things to be influenced to identify the churn person. Am I right? Yes. So based on this, I have displayed only one diagram to understand the concept, followed by after some analysis, you can come for some conclusions. Not only incoming, outgoing calls, number of days since last recharge, it's also low for the churn person. Number of days since last recharge, it is also one of the factor we can identify. It is low for the churn person. And again, the total outgoing, yes, just now we discussed, total outgoing minutes is very low compared with the non-churn persons. Again, the low value of maximum recharged amount. Definitely, the persons are not interested to pay more, to make a big amount recharge if they are interested to switch over from one to another network. Am I right? Yes, that is another factor. So we recommend the telecom company to consider all this driver. This is called as a main influencing factors. Or driver variables, which are all the strong indicator to manage the customer churn. First, we have to identify all these things, and by using all these variables, they can go for prediction. So, at the end of the prediction, what happened? They can easily classify these persons are comes under the churn category, and these persons are comes under the non-churn category. Am I right? So, this is the again. It's an example of classification problem. Okay, I hope. You can understand this concept. Two cases. It's very simple case. And then actually, before we go for conclusion, yes, let us have one more polling to ensure how far you understood the concept. Actually, I am talking nearly 40-50 minutes regarding this predictive analytics. So just I want to ensure how you understood the concept. That is what a very simple question again. Now time for polling. I'll post one question. Just you check whether it is a predictive analytics problem or not. Okay, I hope we can stop. Okay, now I share the result. Just you see, 15% of people voted as it is not a predictive analytics problem. I don't know why they have chosen this no as a result, but the thing is, majority of your students voted as it is a predictive analytics problem. Definitely it's a predictive analytics problem because the TMS wants to prepare the revenue forecast. Actually, what will be their revenue after analyzing a week, month, year's performance or past 1 year performance or week performance, month performance. They want to make a prediction. Okay, so that is what. Okay, and one more question I want to discuss with you. This is the next question. See, students, just little bit carefully you read this question. A retail shop wants to identify their regular customers. They don't want to know the behavior of customer, just identify the regular customer to give some combo offers. Okay. Little bit confusion in this, I hope so. Actually, this is what happened before the predictive analytics coined, am I right? So identifying the regular customer is very simple. It's not necessary to go for prediction and something like that. So to identify the behavior of customer only, we have to go with predictive analytics, right? So here they want just to identify these are all the regular. In our before this predictive analytics has been coined, what happened in our retail shop? They can easily identify we are their regular customer, am I right? To give the combo offer. That is, since you are a regular customer, in this month we are giving discount or we are giving if you buy one thing and then you can get free one more thing and so on. Okay, no issue. But most of the students voted us. It is a not a predictive analytics. Okay, good. Thanks for polling, ma'am. Thanks for polling. Now we come to the end of presentation. Actually, I hope now you know the importance of predictive analytics, how it is important or how it helps in a business. It's very smart way to add more insight and clarity about your business. So that is what, as a techno manager, we can analyze the data. Just what is our requirement? Just we have a data, historical data, that's enough. With this data, we can make more number of, we can find out more number of insights, and then it will help the organizations to improve their business in future. Definitely, it will help the persons to improve their future. So actually, intuitive decision making is also very important. Technical portion is not much important. Intuitively, you can analyze the data and then you can make the decision. So according to that, they can improve their business. And then data size, definitely the data sizes were too high, too huge as right now. Since we are all living in a data world, so for anything, everything, everywhere, anywhere, we have a data. So with the data, with the person's name, instead of identifying a person with a name, nowadays we are identifying a person data by using their Aadhaar card. Am I right? So that is the thing. So that data is very huge amount of data we have in our hand. So based on that, the human, without this analytics concept, we can't do anything with that hand, with that amount of data. So that it's very important. So data-driven decision making is very, very important in the case of predictive analytics. I hope you understood the concept. Okay.